Back with Representative Allyson Schwartz. Let me ask you this. The bipartisan card is the one that, you know, you look at and you say it's almost become impossible. I mean, you're there on the floor with them every day, and of course I'm down here in Florida, but I'm pretty much attuned to what's going on. I just don't see any bipartisan. Can you accomplish things in education and in the energy issue and on health care? Can you do that without this kind of need for bipartisanship? That I just think it's illusory. I just don't see it.
Well, you know, I think the American people want us to, as members of Congress, as their government, to find solutions to the challenges we're facing. And they want us to get things done. And
but they don't really care if it's bipartisan.
Well,
do you think
they think that there ought to be a bipartisan. Well, and I think that we'd like to think it would be bipartisan. But you are also correct that, particularly in the House,
the numbers,
the Republicans you're absolutely right. The Republicans have basically said no to everything.
Well, the numbers, but if you look at the polls, this should be empowering to you. The polls say the public doesn't care. The public simply wants results, and I'm bothered sometimes because I don't think that I don't think enough politicians are looking at these polls. There's a mandate, and they really are saying we really don't care if it's bipartisan. And
so they want us to get things done. Well, what we did in the budget is in health care and in education, we basically said we want to work in a bipartisan way if we can. But if we can't, health care for all Americans and containing costs for our government, for our business, for our families, just simply can't be held hostage to just a couple of Republicans in the Senate. Again, we'd like to do it in a bipartisan way. And actually, in the budget, we'll see if this remains after conference committee, but in the budget we said we're going to give it till the end of September to try and find a bipartisan solution. And if we can't, we're going to have to proceed anyway because it's just too important to – we can't leave it on the table anymore.
Yeah, I think the bipartisanship thing is way overplayed in the House and the Senate. I'm telling you, we follow these numbers every day.
Yeah.
The public doesn't care. Okay, let me skip to something.
I was going to say, one other thing, if I may, about that is the Democratic caucus represents a very wide and broad range of geographic areas and political perspectives. So, you know, they're more conservative and more liberal.
The
and
blue dog from all, issue, sure.
Yeah, and so the fact is that it takes a bit of work just for us to all get that input from all the different Democrats. And that's a pretty broad swath of thinking about this. So
Was it an uphill battle there? I remember the story about Baugh coming out and saying, look, I've got my 20 Blue Dog Democrats. They're not going to cooperate. It sounded like you had your work cut out for you there.
That's what I'm saying. It takes real work. But, you know, look, as a Democrat, I also think it's good to have some debate about these issues. We went along with the president. We were thrilled about the president's budget and his setting these broad goals for the American people, you know, fiscal responsibility and health care and education and energy independence. This is important in the right direction for this country. We were thrilled about that. But we did a little tweaking. That's our job as Congress.
Question about it. But we are at a crossroads here, and these 20 or so Blue Dog Democrats need to understand if it's not done now, it's not going to be done. I mean, this is a window of opportunity. Let me ask you something. The idea is that the Obama budget is radical departure, obviously, from the Ronald Reagan years, where deregulate, cut taxes, and everything's going to be okay, everything's going to trickle down. We know that there's a new day out there, but the new day is that there is a sharp raise in taxes for the rich. I mean, it's well beyond what Bill Clinton talked about or even had in place, right? I mean, what kind of numbers are you talking about?
Let me also say that the budget, again, we didn't get real specific about the taxes.
That.
It's because what we don't do.
I understand that.
So when people say, oh, this is exactly what you're going to do, no, we actually, and again, I'm a member of not only the Budget Committee where I'm vice chair, but I'm also on the Ways and Means Committee, which is a committee that does set tax policy. And we certainly, you know, we care about our jurisdiction,
you know,
and so we're going to work on this. But we do recognize that the very wealthiest Americans, and we're talking about, for example, the estate tax is one area where we did have some discussion on the budget, where we basically said we would like to exempt $3.5 million a person, $7 million a couple can be left to children and heirs, and we think that that's, you know, pretty fair, and it's really a handful of Americans that would have to pay above that. We're really talking about less than 1% of Americans. And the Republicans argued about that. I'm like, wait a minute, we're exempting 99-point-some percentage of Americans and you're arguing about that. It's really quite astounding.
Isn't there a lot of money offshore? I noticed the Chamber of Commerce now has rallied their goons to come to go at anybody who, you know, who threatens the tax havens offshore. That's what is it? $400 billion, some incredible number that stays offshore and is never taxed. Is there any effort on
We're definitely talking about how can we make sure that taxes, really for all Americans, but including corporate taxes, is really fair.
Right.
And we certainly don't want to create tax incentives to offshore more of our jobs and our companies. That said, we do know that many of our companies now are multinational. They have companies offshore that, that actually produce products that don't come back to this country, that are sold offshore. And we want to make sure we do this in a way that doesn't hurt American businesses, but in fact also does and provide, tax incentives for them to offshore jobs. Okay. And that's what we're going to look at. And we also want to make sure that all of our taxes are really fair for middle-income Americans. I mean, one of the things we saw was a growth in the number of people who might have to pay the alternative minimum tax. That was intended for a handful of Americans, and because of the Bush tax cuts, we're talking about millions of Americans into the alternative minimum tax. And we said that we're not going to let that happen for another year. We're going to patch it, as we say, for another year so it doesn't apply to most Americans. But we're going to have to tackle how do we actually handle this in a way that is fair to middle-income Americans.
Okay, one issue. You say you can cut this. I mean, you don't, but I mean the discussion is by 2013 you want to cut the deficit by half. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to get there, you have to make some assumptions, and that is that we're going to have an economy that continues to grow at almost a stellar rate. I mean, historically, I mean, you probably know these numbers better than I do, but my memory is that if 3 to 4% is a stellar growth, we've never had a 10% consistent growth in the economy. And some people are saying it's going to take that to get where you want to get to that 2013 half.
Well, we are looking for economic growth. We also know, as you pointed out and we just talked about, we're also going to need to look at the tax code to make sure that Americans are, that it's fair. And we also want to make sure that Americans are paying their taxes. That's for sure. We know there's a tax gap. And we do know that we have to cut some spending in government. And I think you're going to see some more of that, of making sure that if programs don't work or not terribly effective, we're going to stop doing them. And we'll see some changes in that score as well. And,
mm-hmm.
We're going to hopefully making investments such as in health IT and, technology that really makes sure that we are more efficient and, fewer errors, less duplication, so that we can rein in the growth of healthcare costs.
Mm-hmm.
All of this will help our companies be more competitive and for us to be able to get the kind of dollars in. Look, we know putting people back to work, having them being able to make good wages and be able to pay their, their fair share. That's all important, as well. So this is a lot of work for us to do to meet that goal, but we certainly do believe in that goal, and we're going to try and meet it, and we think we can do it.
Representative Schwartz, you did some stellar work on this budget. Let's hope that we can take those great ideas and actually put them to work.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye-bye.